part of what we have been going through. Book of 1 Thessalonians. The Apostle Paul was writing to the Thessalonians, sometimes answering questions they had asked, but sometimes addressing the problems that was going on in their church, in their local church. And we reach 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. If you use the Bibles we have here, the English Bible is page 1871, the Chinese 361, the Korean 332, Spanish 1498, and the Teen Bible 1455. We reach a point where God has inspired Paul to first, as we read last week, talk to them about, they had questions about those who had fallen asleep, those who had died in Christ. What would happen to them? He mentioned that to them in the previous chapter. And then he was answering some other question about the day of the Lord. When everybody wants to know, when will the end be? When will Christ comes back? You know, that's what everybody wants to know. When will the world end? Is it going to happen in our lifetime? You know, everyone thinks it will happen in their lifetime. Don't you guys feel like that before? You always think it will happen in your lifetime. Whenever there's a war where a lot of countries get together, we always think it's going to be the war that ends all wars. But as I mentioned before, the end of the world doesn't come with us fighting each other. It comes with people who want to fight against God. So anyway, they had the same question here. They asked about when will all this happen? When will this all be? And the Apostle Paul is writing to address them. And he says in chapter 5, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1, it says, "Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates, we do not need to write to you. For you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." So it's as though he had already told them that before. Christ is coming like a thief in the night. How does a thief come? Unexpected, right? Unexpected. But Jesus Christ comes not to steal, comes to give. But even though the thief comes unexpected and unwanted, sometimes, you know, for some people, when Jesus comes back, will be unwanted. And some people may say, "I'm not ready. God, I'm not ready for you to come back yet. I'm still living my life my own way. I want to do some things my way." Or this might say, "Perhaps I'm not good enough. I'm not good enough for when Christ comes back. So I'm not ready." You know, I was, silly said, my wife and I were in the Coast Guard, and the Coast Guard, they have a motto, "Semper Paratus," means always ready. You know, we were always ready for whatever happened. You know, you're on a small boat in New York City. We're in a small boat. We used to patrol the waters. And at any minute, the alarm can go off. The next thing you know, we run to the boat, put on the boat, and speed away and go over to do whatever we have to do, save people or put out fires on the water. We were always ready. You know, if we had patrol, we'd always wear a gun, and we always have it with us wherever we go. We go to eat, we have it with us. At nighttime, we have our clothes right by our beds, so as soon as the alarm goes off when we're sleeping, we just jump right in it and go. We're always ready. But God says when he's coming back, he wants us to be like that. We should be always ready. And now, are you always ready? Are you always ready to meet Christ when he comes back? He comes like a thief in the night. He comes unexpected. As he says in verse 3, "While people are saying peace and safety, destructions will come on them suddenly, as labor pains of a pregnant woman, and they will not escape." You know, some people will not escape God's wrath when he comes. But is God coming to punish people? You know, many people like to focus on God's coming. Yeah, he's going to come and he's going to get you. No, that's not the goal of God's coming. God's goal is not to punish people. God's coming to save you. That's what he's coming for, to save you. And if you're a Christian and you believe in God, you know that he's coming to save you. Verse 4, verse 3 again, he comes as labor pains on a pregnant woman, because a pregnant woman doesn't know when the water is going to break. She just doesn't know. But as most pregnant women, they're always ready, right? They have their bag ready to go. And that's how God wants us to be, always ready to receive him. Verse 4, but you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness, so that this day should not surprise you like a thief. See, if you're close to God, it doesn't come to you like totally unaware. you can see certain signs that are happening, right? Certain things that the Bible said in Revelation will happen before Jesus Christ returned. And no matter what people say about the blood moon and all that stuff, you know, three blood moons, whatever, in such and such time, the end of the world will come. There's nothing in the Bible talks about a blood moon. Right? It doesn't. It talks about one moon, right, changing, right, looked like blood when Jesus Christ returns. There isn't about three blood moons or four blood moons. Nope, nobody knows. And the moons that we see right now, it looks orange. It looks kind of faded yellow, right, like a tannish color. But God said, you know, when the end of the world comes, the moon will turn like blood red. I'm thinking blood red in those days were the same blood red today. So if we see the moon kind of orange or faded yellow, that's not what God is talking about. The end is not yet. So that day doesn't come up on a surprise because we're always ready for it. Always ready. Not that we know, but we will always be ready. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in the darkness so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. Meaning said, we are following God. If you're following God's ways, God will not leave you in the dark because you're walking in his light. What did Jesus tell the disciples? You are the light of the world. God put you on a hill. You cannot be hidden. You know, we must be light. We must be the righteousness for people that are around us. If we are not, then we're in the dark. You know, we are the prince of darkness. Verse 6, so then let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. Now, he just talked about in a previous chapter about those who have fallen asleep. And those who have fallen asleep, we know that are dead. So he said, don't be like those people that are dead, right? We have to be people that are alive. We don't sleep, we don't drink. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. Right? God doesn't want us to be having parties and getting drunk and being like that. It's a spiritual drunkenness to where you're unaware of what God wants you to do. You know, sometimes people get drunk, and they may use that as an excuse to do things, but sometimes people get drunk and they're unaware of what's going on. And God is telling us we are not like people who are drunk. We're always aware of what God is doing. And we should always be aware of what God is doing. Verse 8, but since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on the faith and love as the breastplate and the hope of salvation, as a helmet. Right? He said, but since we belong to the day, let us be sober. You know, we belong to God. We belong to the light. The day represents the lightness and brightness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's what we should represent. We should represent everything good about Jesus. Everything good about Jesus. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as breastplates and the hope of salvation as a helmet. Right? God's love as a breastplate. God's love should always be in our hearts. We should not have an excuse not to love or show kindness to people or generosity. We should always be willing to do that for God. And the hope of salvation, we should always have hope that Jesus is coming to give you eternal life. He's coming to give you eternal life, not to condemn you, not to kill you. He's coming to give you eternal life because that's what Jesus said. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Right? All, not some, but all. God wants to save all of us. Some of us may reject him, but his goal is to save all of us. Verse 9, for God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. And that's one thing we should say. See, God appoints us for salvation. Salvation is eternal life. Right? God is giving us eternal life. God has given us the gift of eternal life, the ability to live forever. Right? Some of us don't want to live forever. You know, my grandfather wanted to end his life. He wrote a letter saying, I want to die. Some people just wants to die. They want to get it over with. Why is that? Why does people want to commit suicide? You know, a lot of times when people commit suicide, they said, man, how could you do such a selfish thing? When is suicide a selfish thing? If somebody want to kill themselves and you tell them, or attempted to kill themselves, and you tell them, man, you're so selfish, is that really a selfish thing? Or is it the fact that the person is hurting? Right? They need God's comfort. They need you to comfort them and encourage them, right? And telling them that it's a selfish thing is not comforting. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we live together with him. Right? Do we know that? Do we know that we have God's Holy Spirit? And what does God's Holy Spirit do? I asked this question before. When you have God's Holy Spirit, what does it mean? No. Okay, what does it mean in reference to salvation? What does it mean in reference to eternal life? Right? Ephesians tell you when you have God's Holy Spirit, it guarantees your inheritance. Right? Inheritance. Some of us, we know we have God's Holy Spirit, but we still worry. Why worry? God has given you his Holy Spirit. It's like a seal of approval. It's a stamp on you. USDA, good beef. Right? When God stamps you, puts the seal of approval on you, nobody can change it. Jesus said that, right? He said, nobody can snatch him out of my hands. Nobody can snatch him out of my Father's hands. Right? Once you're saved, you're saved. You're completely saved. You don't turn away from God. Why? Why you don't turn away? Because God doesn't give up on you. He doesn't let you turn away. Yeah, you may suffer, but the consequences of your foolish things that you're doing, right? You might try to run away from God, but you know what? He doesn't give up. He finds ways to get you back, even if you end up in jail or the hospital. He finds ways to get you back. I'm telling you, he doesn't give up on you. You know, I know this man that killed, I told you before, this man that killed his aunt, he killed her. And his sister told me he grew up in church, he knew church. And I went to talk to him and he said because he was on drugs, he would steal from her and she didn't want to give him the money, so he hit her with a baseball bat. He killed her and he kept hitting her until he made sure she was dead. Well, he was in prison, and in prison he was a nice, nice young man. You know, nice, talking in a very... You would never think he's a killer because of the drugs. You see, the drugs. Is there forgiveness for that? Is there forgiveness for somebody that's so cruel? Yes, Jesus Christ died on the cross and he said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And they stabbed him in the side. They planned his death. Right? They planned it for months. Remember, Jesus stayed away from Jerusalem for a long time before he went there. Because you know when he goes there, he will die. But yet, he said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And when Jesus says, Father, forgive them, that means they are forgiven. They are forgiven. And God wants us to be like that. God wants us to always be forgiven. Like little children. Little children always forgive. Well, some people like dogs. You ever had a dog? Anybody have a dog? You ever beat your dog? Your dog was bad, you know? Because your parents beat you, so you beat up your dog. That's a bad example I learned from my parents, you know. Take it out of the dog. You know, you beat the dog 1 minute, next minute the dog comes close to you and be loving to you. Do you know that? If you have dogs, you know that. Right? Dogs always forgiving. Yeah, I know what you're thinking. Yes, I'm saying that. God wants you to be like a dog. He wants you to be forgiving like a dog, right? But not forgiving like a dog, he wants you to be forgiving like him, right? Because he is forgiving. Verse 10, he died for us so that whether we awake or asleep, we live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. See, God wants us to build people up, encourage them, you know, continue to build them up. To know, let them know that, hey, God died for you. He loved you. He cares for you. God is not coming back to punish you. He's coming to bring you good things. Verse 12. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord, and who admonish you. So there were people that were there. Probably, perhaps they asked these questions, or maybe he's just giving them encouragement. About what they should do to people, you know, who work, who teach them about God, who is there to look over them, to oversee them. He said in verse 13, hold them in the highest regard, in love, because of their work. Right? Some sometimes, you know, we have hard works to do. We were just talking about that yesterday. You know, I come here sometimes and I'm a janitor, you know. I feel like I'm a janitor because I'm sweeping, I'm cleaning, I'm looking for mouse, if there's any. Auntie Linda comes on the weekend and cleans up toilets and stuff, but sometimes during the week I'm doing it. You know, I'm like a janitor. Try to see what's wrong with our church, what needs fixing. And whatever it is, there is, you know, God calls me to do it in spite of my work that I have every day. And God blesses me. I told Auntie Linda yesterday, God gives me energy, you know, to do these things. Sometimes I don't sleep much. My wife knows, sometimes I don't sleep much, but I get up the next day very early, awake. And I don't always use an alarm. Sometimes 4 o'clock comes, I just wake up. You know, I look over and I see the clock is 3:59, you know, and I wake up. And I'm very awake. But if I use an alarm and I put that snooze on and I sleep, I it's hard to get back up. Very hard to get back up. Snooze is not a good thing. You know, it makes you sleepy. Anyway, verse 13 again. Hold them in the highest regard in love because of their work. Live in peace with everyone. You know, we need to live in peace with our neighbors. You know, I always say my neighbor is here, I live in peace with her. If we weren't at peace, she wouldn't be here. She'd probably go on Facebook and say, that Richard guy, he's a hypocrite. Don't ever go to this church. And my other neighbor, you know, I haven't seen him since I gave him the blocks. You know, he's, you know, I haven't seen him. I gave him blocks, I gave him orange juice. I didn't tell my wife, you know, but they wrote a nasty note and they put it in my mailbox. You know, and I never mentioned that to anybody, but he put a nasty note. And even though he put a nasty note, or whoever, I know he came from their house because of what it said, I still see them and I smile and I say good morning, hello, how are you? You know, I still do that. I'm good to my neighbor. God say, though, with Christians and believers, we need to be at peace with each other. Because we need to show the example to everyone else that sees us, everyone else that around us, that we can live at peace because we are God's children. There's benefits to being God's children. You have a family where you can show your love, the love of God to. And other peoples are always attracted to love, right? People are always attracted to love. Verse 14, and we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive. Right? Some people are idle. You know, they look, they got nothing to do. So when, what happens when you're idle? You get in trouble. Right? We know that with children. When children are idle, they get in trouble. So you got to keep them busy. Right? Warn those who are idle. Encourage the disheartened. Right? Look for people that need encouragement and encourage them. Help the weak. Be patient with everyone. You know, God wants us to encourage people. You know, this girl called me this weekend or phoned me on Facebook, and she was coming to San Francisco and she needed help. And she said she wrote a letter to pastors because her parents was really worried about her coming here all by herself. And I'm the only one that responded to her and went and helped her. She said no other church did it. She was kind of surprised that I did it. And I explained to her because people want, you know, they want something out of doing things for people, right? They want something. Nobody want to do nothing. Nobody want to do something for nothing. They want something out of it. And one of the people always, after, one of the pastors, I guess, wrote her back and said, what church you belong to? And then when she said what religion she was, they didn't want to help her. You know, they said, sorry. But God doesn't call us to be like that. God bring people among us so that we can help them sometimes. Of course, there are people who want to take advantage of us, but that's not our problem, right? God wants us to help people when he shows us people that needs help. And he puts that in our hearts to help them. Anyway, I went and helped the girl, and she's a very nice young girl from Africa, from Nigeria, studying law in Golden Gate University. And we've been trying to get a place for her, and yesterday she texted me and said she found a place close to school. She was also shocked that the price is in San Francisco. Very shocked. She's shocked about it. Verse 15, make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong. See, that's what God wants. You don't pay somebody back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Right? Not just for our Christian brothers and sisters, but for everyone else. God wants us to represent his goodness, not revenge. Because Jesus said, or God said, vengeance is mine to repay, right? It's not for us to do it. It's for God to do it. And this is how Christians should be, right? If you see a Christian's always sad, you know, like the whole world is against them, you know, like they always say, poor me, poor me. Would you be attracted to that?
No.
But if it says in like verse 16, if we rejoice always, right? If they see that's always rejoicing, always happy, then they want to know, why are you so happy? You know, why are you so happy? You know, I always think, my wife may not like this, but if I always think about anybody live in my home, what if my house were to burn down? And I used to think about that before. What if my house were to burn down and I have nowhere to go? What would I do? How could I rejoice in that? And then I thought, I can make my house deeper down, you know. And I can put a pool in the backyard. You know, I can jump from the top floor and jump in the pool, you know. So rejoice, right? No matter what happened, you know, you got to rejoice. Because whatever is happening, is God is allowing it to happen. And if he's allowing it to happen, he's allowing it for our good. That's how we have to look at it. It's happening for our good. Rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. You think he really means all circumstances? You know, some of us, it's hard to thank God for trials. You know, when bad things happen in our life, we don't want to thank God for it. You know, it's not till later on that we realize, oh, I went through this so that I could understand this. You know, God sometimes allows you to go through hardship because he's preparing you for understanding or perhaps counseling or dealing with others. Or sometimes it's just so you can show an example to those who are seeing the hardship that you're going through and the joyful attitude that you have. So they will know that, you know, you're not trusting in material things, but you're trusting in God. You know, and you know that God will take care of you because he has given you proof that he has taken care of you before. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit. You know, I mean, to say, do not hold it back. You know, God has given you his Spirit. He has given you certain gifts. Use those gifts. Right? Use them to encourage people. Use them in a way God would be pleased and be happy that he has given you a gift. Do not treat prophecy with contempt, but test them all. Hold to what is good, respect and reject every kind of evil. You know, some people perhaps prophesy or preach bad words, or some people may predict things that are not true. Right? So we have to test it. How do we know? Well, we have to hear it first. Are they really talking from God, or are they just talking? I mean, so many people have come up to me and said, Richard, God gave me this vision for you. And I said, okay, what's the vision? A lot of times it doesn't happen. But you know, when people come to me and say, God gave me this vision for you, you know what comes to my mind? In the early 80s, I went to see a fortune teller. That's what comes to my mind. You know, I went to see a fortune teller, and the fortune teller, I told you the story, tell me and this girl, I see you guys together, you're going to get married, you're going to be happy and have children, and she wasn't even my girlfriend. You know, I just went there with her because she didn't want to go by herself. And I wasn't that close to God at that time. If I was, I would have encouraged her not to go in there. So anyway, God say, test them, right? You have to, in order to test it, you have to hear it. And if it comes through every time the person tells you, then you know they're speaking from God. But if it doesn't come through, even once, they're not speaking for God. Right? Verse 23, may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through, meaning to say, God will do it. Maybe he do it. He will do it. Certainly do it. Your whole body, may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. See, they worried about Christ coming, and he said, don't worry about Christ coming. Just make sure you stay close to God. You know, focus on the gifts God has given you. Use it. Use it for the glory of God. Verse 24, the one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. He will come. God will sanctify you. Or he already sanctified us. God has already set us apart, right, for his kingdom. That's why we're learning about God. If he didn't set us apart, we wouldn't be learning about God. We wouldn't think about him at all. But God has set us apart. As you know, the United States, that's why I said we pray for the President Trump, because he's the only one protecting Christians at the moment. People are not. You know, even in the workplace, you try to act as though you're a Christian, people are quick to try to put you down and tell you, you know, don't preach your religion here. Especially, I work for Congress. Don't bring your preaching here. You know, there is a law between church and state. You know, they always tell me that. And you know what I tell them? It's freedom of religion, not freedom from religion. Right? It's freedom of religion. That's the law. So they cannot stop me. Lately, I've been more bold, you know, posting things all up over the federal building. And I heard some people take it down. So what I did, I put my name now. And I put who I work for. And nobody took it down. People are not taking it down anymore. But God wants us to be alive, and he wants us to be strong in our faith. Because as it says in verse 24, the one who calls us is faithful, and he will do it. Then he ends with, brothers and sisters, pray for us. Greet all God's people with a holy kiss. You know, be loving and compassionate to people. Greet them with a holy kiss. I charge you before the Lord to have this letter read in all to all the brothers and sisters. Right? He wanted everybody to hear what he had to say. And he wanted to make sure the letter, you know, the letters would be passed around to the different churches in Macedonia. And Thessalonian was one of the towns in Macedonia. But it would be passed around within the churches. They didn't have Bibles like we had here today, right? But whatever letter Paul wrote, it became a part of the Bible. It was passed around. And then he ends with the grace of our Lord Jesus be with you. Right? And pray that God is with you. See, we have all been called into God's kingdom. So we should not be afraid or ashamed of the day of the Lord. We should be looking forward to it. Especially us now when we get old and we get sick, and we want a better body. God said he's going to give you a better body. Right? I'm going to have my 18-year-old body when God comes back. That's what I'm thinking. You know, that's my talk to God. I'm going to look sharp. Maybe you're not going to be, but I'm going to have my 18-year-old body. Because people used to live hundreds of years old. What did they look like when they were 300? If you live 900 years old, what do you look like when you were 300? You're still young. You're still young. So let's look forward to God's coming with joy, with a joyful heart, so others can know that what's this joy that you have? Yeah, God is coming back, and he's going to give us a new life, a new body. Amen? Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, God, we are thankful for you. God, we are grateful for the love, the mercy that you have given us. Lord God, we look forward to you returning to us, God. As you have said, God, when we see you, we will be like you, because, God, you will give us a new body, a body that does not decay, an immortal body. Lord Jesus Christ, we are thankful for the blessing that you have given us. We pray, God, that you continue, God, to increase and strengthen our faith so that we can trust in you, and, God, that we will wholeheartedly wait for you. No matter what we go through, God, we will focus on the blessing, or should I say the greatest blessing that anyone could ever get, and that is your gift of eternal life. We thank you and for your mercy and your grace. In Jesus Christ, your name, God, we pray. Amen. Everybody has to know. Everybody has to know. Jesus.